John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Several back things are going to be on the back, and they're going to take their time changing, so they shouldn't be too distracting. And that's the one. One of them, you don't have to turn to it, because we can see it already. That one's one of the thoughts. John chapter 8 is one of the main texts. Revelation 10 is the other one. If you want to turn there, you can have your thumb there, or you can just listen. It's going to be short over there, just to bump through, because there's so many places to look at, but I'm not going to look at. I'm not going to be flipping through a lot tonight. I usually don't do that. I'm going to be talking about a couple things. There's the only thing I can really think about is just some stuff that I feel like I was really hearing a lot of the book of John, and I would like to talk about a little bit of all of it, but I'm just going to read over some of the John chapter 8, where the Lord is talking about what it means to be set free, first of all. So there's an actual encounter with Jesus. And 8:36 is a classic scripture that we hear all the time. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. And we're going to look at a little bit before and a little bit after that and see if we can gather the context of it and find out why did he say that. And also I want to recognize another thought here in regards to just the Word of God itself. And if I'm gathering the thoughts correctly from the 2 Timothy, the writer being Paul to Timothy. You know, there's probably a few people gathered together in the Spirit where they're concluding at one point to say all Scripture is given, all Scripture is breathed, all Scripture is inspired. And we know there's a lot of things about the Word of God, and I wanted to start to touch on this doctrine called bibliology, which there's a lot of doctrines in it. And I'm going to show you a couple of the nuggets of what I've gathered thus far, and I didn't write any notes down because it's just right there. So I'm just going to kind of jump a couple places through this first chunk here, and I'm starting to crack into something I thought was going to be pretty obvious and simple, but it's actually kind of nice to be able to see people put things together and see things that we do and don't might not agree totally with. But it's nice to see what has been laid down as fundamentals, you know, decades before us. So, the Word of God, we do want to continue to stand for the preciseness of all of this. It's not just some of the Scripture. It's all Scripture is God-given. It doesn't need to be any more, and it doesn't need to be any less. The Bible is perfect the way it is, and it doesn't need to be added to, and it doesn't need to be subtracted from. And that's some of these things that I'm going to be talking about would probably sound extremely obvious to us, but because of all the spirits going around, because of all the voices going around, it's important to continue to state the obvious, because it isn't obvious when people get into darkness. Amen. It isn't obvious, because it's not something that you can just see or memorize in your mind, where that is very important. And having things in your mind is a very important thing, but there's more to it. The soul loses sight when darkness starts to come upon you. And the focus from Christ, who sets free, starts to become not in focus anymore, and all of a sudden strange things start to feel more compatible to your current view and your current position of your spirit, and your heart is in a specific spot, and things look different as your heart changes. And Titus mentions that a heart that is clean sees everything like clean. They're motivated, and then they motivate everyone. And people who have a heart that is dark and discouraged, they discourage everyone. They aren't going to help you with your vision because they aren't following God's vision for their life. And I don't really know how anyone could really motivate someone to go all the way with the Lord unless they are going all the way with the Lord. It's very difficult to try and teach other people how to obey the Holy Spirit when your obedience is not fulfilled. So we're going to take a look at a few different thoughts today and see if we can gather them together, look at the word. The word says itself. And I want to make sure that I'm not being misquoted from things I've said a lot of the times when I tell people we didn't always have a Bible. I do believe that we haven't always had a Bible, and I know the New Testament church didn't have the New Testament Bible in their hands, but at the same time, this word is still God's word. His word is truth, and his word is pure, and his word is preserved, his word is eternal, his word is powerful, and his word is a sword. His word is so many different things, and to be esteemed extremely highly by anyone and everyone. So we're going to take a look at a couple of the arguments against the Word of God, and something that we know is plain and obvious, but I wanted us to see why it's important that we state the obvious, because of some of the thoughts that people do have that make it so things that we have just taken for as normal understanding, people say things that will make it not like that and make us not have total trust in God's Word. And I believe that God is real, and I believe His Spirit is real, and I believe that His working in people's life is real, and I believe the Word, the Kingdom of God, isn't necessarily in Word, but it is in power. I do recognize that, but today I want to glory in the Word of God and take a look at a few things about it that is actually really powerful. So it might start to sound a little bit like Bible college, and that's okay, because I think it's fun to learn. I'm starting to see that learning and having some understandings developed in the moment is actually really key for the moment. So everybody's minds are clear on what the thoughts are, according to some of the brilliant wonders and the sovereign wonders of the Word of God. Some of the powerful divine points of the Word of God, which the list is considerable, and coming from so many different angles about how divine the Word of God really is. And it's fun to look at those together, and then the preaching starts to take form as the Word of God is exalted. And it ought to be, amen? So I want to pray, and I want to just ask the Lord to help us put this Word together and to, you know, share a couple of things I think from this book is extremely powerful. And we're going to take a first step to look at what does it mean to be set free by Jesus, who is not dead, who is alive, and He's not letters on pages. And also to some of the divine wonders of the Bible that we can look at a bird's eye view, as opposed to just reading it. You know, there's people who've read it a lot, and they've gathered great points together, and they put it all together, and boy, it feels good to read it. So we're going to look at a couple things. The Lord Himself, the Word, and the Word. Amen. Father, we love You, and we thank You, God, for your Bible, God. And we know that not everyone has had the privilege to have a Bible throughout the church history, God. And I pray that we would handle it the right way, and I pray that we would read it the right way and to see it the right way. To know that it is a high privilege, Lord, that because they didn't have it before doesn't mean that we don't need it today. That we do need it, and we're going to be held to a higher standard, possibly, than they who didn't have the Bible readily available. To us in America with Bibles in stacks on our shelves at almost every home are going to be held to an accountability to say you had the Word of God. And I pray that, Lord, we would be excited and challenged and know that there's a lot to search about the beauties of Your Word, but also to know that there's a responsibility with the privileges that You do give. And so much is given, much is required. So I pray that not only will we recognize the potentials, but also the requirements as well for us as the human race, to not pretend like You're not real, and also as we do acknowledge your existence and that You are real and You are worthy to be sought, that not only would we recognize that You are real and not ignore You even as we acknowledge that You're real, God, I pray that we would yearn to lean deeper into You. Learn to listen to Your Holy Spirit in a mightier, mightier way, Lord God. That we could realize that You are being for real with us when you let us know Your requirements. And that we will come to You and offer You that which You do require from each and every individual as they are currently at and at the light that they currently are. I pray that no one would try to offer You a sacrifice from eyes that isn't current for them or a place that they used to see. And pretend that that's going to be worthy of You, Lord God. I pray that we would not do that for the eyes of man looking on, but we would do what is pleasing in Your sight, Lord God. That we would not do things for the opinions of other people, but we would do it because of Your good pleasure. Knowing that it's Your your joy that gives us strength, God. It is pleasing you that is going to make us live, God. For the new thing that you've done in our life, God, is only going to be real and effective, God, when we are going to be ourselves before you as we currently are, Lord. I pray that all compromise would be abolished. I pray that all sin would be crucified. All the affections and the lusts of this world would be utterly destroyed from the face of our own little worlds, that we would walk with no hindrances, no barriers, as we walk the full course as you are calling us to. I pray that all this would be crucified, that we would be a crucified people, pushing the world behind and the compromises behind, and let the cross be ahead of us, Lord God. May we march to the beat of a drum of eternity. And may we be the people that will walk where you are and let your words take effect in our hearts, not like the Pharisees who didn't really see your words, Lord. But let us see and receive the words in the proper way. Help us to exalt your word to get today, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, bless every heart. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, I've already started this book several times, and I've actually gotten through it more and more, and I've tried different things trying to get it onto the screen so I could read it more and whatnot, is some of the things I was doing, and also some of the backdrops for the lists that we're going to be working on for quite a while until we can start to really memorize them, because it's really, really helpful and very powerful as we are stepping out. And it's something that I definitely want to see everybody doing, is stepping out to be available to share, and having these in our arsenal as weapons of mass destruction to the devil, amen, and the untold damage that he's done and locked people's spirits up so much that the words of God aren't seen. They are not seen, and if they are seen, they're not being seen for the way that God wants them to be seen, and they're being twisted by false prophets, they're being twisted by liberal theologians, and making the incredible authority of the Word of God a very, very light matter for a lot of eyes, and that is not the way God wants us to see it. So I'm going to go ahead and start with the Word of God and just say thank God for the list. I think that's it's a big change that's going on, not only with this new church that we've been helping out at. I can see a different utterance happening in this ministry, my own personal walk, first of all, and new challenges come along again. It's quite considerable to see all that comes along with the new stages in our life with the Lord. It seems like everything's going in the right direction. Not without a war, that's for sure, but praise the Lord. So this is after the Lord is going to be dealing with the woman who has been caught in adultery. And it's down over here, a little further down. I'm going to start right here in verse 20 and just go down until we get towards where we were looking at here and see if we can't see this interesting dilemma of how the word has been twisted here. And I'm sure you'll recognize it quite quickly. So, verse 20, these words spake Jesus in the treasury, as he taught in the temple, and no man laid hands on him, for his hour was not yet come. Amen. Then said Jesus again unto them, I go my way, and ye shall seek me, and shall die in your sins. Whether I go, ye cannot come. Then said the Jews, will he kill himself? Because he saith, whither I go, ye cannot come. And he said unto them, ye are from beneath, I am from above. Ye are of this world, I am not of this world. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. Then said they unto him, who art thou? And Jesus said unto them, even the same that I said unto you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. They understood not that he spake to them of the Father. Then said Jesus unto them, when ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. And he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. And he spake these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and we're never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, If ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, We be not born of fornication. We have one Father, even God. Jesus said unto them, If God were your Father, ye would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because ye cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, and ye believe it not, which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you believe me not? Amen. It says right there, He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore heareth not them, because you're not of God. See? You see a few things that he's making utterly clear, that this whether or not you committed sin, okay? The Bible talks about those that will walk in darkness, okay? It's a lifestyle of literally purposefully walking in darkness. This is a person who can't hear God's word, because God is light. God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. And those that want to walk with God are going to come to Jesus this way. He says, They that committed sin are a servant of sin, but if the Son will set you free from living a life of walking in darkness and committing sin, ye shall be free, not to walk in darkness, but to walk free of darkness, to walk totally free of all sin. That's what the Lord is saying right here. And he says, if you really were doing that, you guys would be doing what Abraham did, which he never killed anybody. You guys would be living sin-free, and you would understand my words. Those that will commit sin don't hear the words of the Lord, okay? Now, it's really, really creepy. Now, I remember that list, that's one of the five lists that we have seen on here, where it starts with unconcerned, and then the next one says it's concerned, then conviction, then repentance, then saving faith. That right whole thing is going from totally dark into totally saved. That's the salvation part, which you see, salvation, just one part of the holiness standard. I know we can break it down simply into three, or however. You've seen how we break it down in several different ways. But I thought, isn't it amazing that people can take a sinner that is unconcerned, and they can make him go from unconcerned all the way to saving faith without even being concerned or convicted or even repenting? When Jesus makes it utterly clear, he says, you don't understand my words. That's why a lot of people who really have learned this cheap gospel, and they haven't looked at the Word of God as it's supposed to be looked at, they jump from unconcerned all the way to saved, and they take it so lightly, and they never have any time where they really stop walking in darkness. They don't even realize it's darkness. It seems right. Of course it seems right, because you've never been convicted. The Holy Spirit has never really taken root in your heart, and so His words never really make sense to you at the magnitude that God wants it to. You know, like we were talking about last week, when we have chromosomes from our parents, and we also have a chromosome that comes from the Spirit of the living God. He regened us, he regenerated us with a washing of regeneration to make us a whole nother person that now understands the kingdom words of God. They make sense to you. They're spiritually discerned. And until God does that thing to you, which won't happen until you really stop wanting to walk in darkness, because you realize even the things you thought was good is still darkness. That's why the Bible says even your righteousness is filthy rags to me. He says, you have no idea how off you guys really are. And I believe until the church really starts to remember how off we really are according to what the Word is actually saying, the people are going to continue in their own version of righteousness. They're going to have their version of righteousness, and someone else is going to have a slightly different view. And I'm like, all the different views of churches today, it's almost like all these people difference of their favorite foods. This is my favorite food. This is my favorite food in my flesh. This is the things I don't like. This is the things I don't like. And we've done that with the church. We've done that with the Word of God. You say, this is the kind of stuff I like, and then I'll eliminate the rest. And I've been around groups that are not very, very serious and very dogmatic about their views. They're not really militant about their parameters. And they have their really low view, and they still indulge in all kinds of things that is very, very worldly. And then you got other people who have their own little extreme groups, and they'll take extreme measures and say, this is what the Word says. This is what the Word says over here. This is what the Word says over here. And among every one of those groups, they've eliminated the other things that's in the Scriptures repeatedly. I've never found one group that has not fallen to that, that is an extreme thing. We are the one that really knows. This is what the Bible really says. And every single group who talks like that, it's amazing how they cannot really take all the Scripture. They don't really take them all. And it's like, if that's how you're going to look at it, you're going to take them all, and you're going to find that that's not the way you're supposed to do it, okay? The Word of God is going to come here and show you the words of eternal life, and you'll understand the context of everything that was going on and how God really was working. But until this world of sin, this world of living a committed sin life, you're committed to live your own way, you're never going to have this thing happen. You're never going to be concerned that maybe I'm really not right with God. Maybe I've never been convicted of my sins. But God wants us to be able to pry us out of where we are and to reveal us, to show us His real Spirit of God, the real glory of God. Now, the thing I wanted to look at in this doctrine called bibliology, I thought was really, really great, and I still do. And I'm only going to touch a little bit on the matter here. The Bible says that the word Bible comes from the Greek word biblion, which is the plural form of biblia, meaning books. It just means books. It's a compilation of books. So any type of book of books, you could call it a Bible, which you've seen, like, I want to talk about a bartender's Bible and whatever, because it's just several different books of all kinds of different books. That's all it is. And this is the one we realize should be considered the book. Amen? It should be called the book. And ultimately, you know, we've divided the two things into the Old Testament and the New Testament. There's a whole list of things we've already gone through. We already know the whole list of all the Scriptures and what Genesis and every... We all know pretty much what all the books are about, and that was not a whole lot of emphasis. But the part that really started to jump out to me was this one called the central theme of the Bible, Jesus Christ. It is its theme. And the part that I thought was really powerful, it says, since the Bible presents the unfolding of God's gracious plan of redemption, it can be stated without reservation that the Lord Jesus Christ is ultimately the central theme of both the Old and New Testaments. And let's see, the following diagram is typical for those writers who have attempted to demonstrate the centrality of Christ in both Testaments. And so this is really sweet. This is the Old Testament. Christ is, he's shown in shadow. And in the New Testament, he's in substance. He's not just like shadows of things to come. He's actually standing right there. Like the book of Ruth kind of shows a portrait of the kinsman redeemer. So it's maybe what he means by shadow, or in pictures or in person. In the Old Testament, he comes in type or in truth. In ritual, and he comes in reality. He comes in latent, and he comes in the New Testament as patent. Comes prophesied, and then he comes present. Implicitly revealed, explicitly revealed. And so at the end of the Bible, we look at that, like the beginning into the end again, the goal and the fulfillment of God's redemption plan. Here's another one of these lists to go on, from Genesis to Revelation. Paradise was lost because of sin, and then because of Christ, and the revelation of Christ, paradise is regained. Satan's work begins, and Satan's work is ended. says Satan's work is destruction, but I was over at the car shop reading this thing today, and I just started laughing, thinking, you just say Satan's work is over. Amen. Satan's work is done. He already messed everything up, and he, as well as a lot of people, wanted to go outside of God's sovereign plan, and they want to be like God and start to put themselves above God and rule their own life and not submit to the way God has it. Beginning of the curse, end of the curse. The first sorrow and the end of sorrows. The beginning of struggles and then the final victory. Loss of communion with God because of sin and perfect communion with God. Re-put it all back together again. Heavens and earth affected by the fall. In Revelation, the new heavens and the new earth. So we see, like we've talked about before, actually I think a lot of people weren't even here for that time, but the fulfillment of all things, the New Testament in Christ, is the fulfillment of all things. Everything God meant to happen came apart because of sin, and the redemption plan put back together again because of Christ. Amen? Amen. So the beginning of the whole thing was actually in regards to one of the many things. I didn't realize how many things there were about it, but obviously it's a huge book, so I'm going to tell you the little bit that I do know right now, and we'll go from there. It's about the inspiration of the scriptures, whether or not they're actually inspired or not, and what's the difference between inspiration and revelation. And so revelation is the imparting of truth by God to man, which could not otherwise be known. Pretty powerful, huh? I even heard one guy that I thought was actually kind of a modern liberal kind of guy. He's really smart about a lot of things, but he seems to have a way of communicating that makes people not concerned. Like I said, a church that's not concerned, not converted and not concerned. It's a really, really, it's a really scary thought. But he said revealed knowledge is exact. He says everybody looks at the Bible and they come up with different ideas about what it says. He says it is truth, but it's not always exact. I mean, you can tell because people cannot come up with the same conclusion, so we don't know all the time. But he says revealed knowledge is exact. It's exactly what God says. It's like if you see what God shows you, that's something God has revealed to man you would not have otherwise known. And inspiration, on the other hand, refers to the reception and recording of the truth. Okay, so if God ever spoke to you, something in the supernatural, and you wrote it down, that would be the inspiration. This is an inspired thing. Okay, like we see in the scripture, it says all scripture that we have here is all inspired, and that's something that can be taken a look at, because not all of them are prophets. Not everybody's a prophet. Some people are writing things down under eyewitness things, you know, which is actually what brings up another thought. I'm going to go ahead and jump to that before I forget it, because I don't have this one written down. But when it comes to the book of Genesis, I didn't know this. This is actually really, really, really powerful, and this might be news to you too. But like, when it comes to the creationists fighting the evolutionists, is a lot of the things I wanted to street preach about. That's why I wanted to have a short meeting today, so we can get out to St. Helens and do some street wars out there. Amen. And turn the whole city around, and we're all going to be a part of it. I believe we've been under some fun battles this week, I'm sure, because I know the Lord's got something special for us to make a very definite mark to this world before we leave and before He comes. Amen. But when it comes to creationists versus evolution, they try and tell you something that is so far beyond your mind. To say 100 years. Most people haven't even been alive 100 years. They look back and say, oh man, that was 30 years ago. That's a long time ago. That's a big chunk of my life. 30 years ago, that's a long time. So you say 100 years ago, that's somewhat understandable. That's three times what my whole life has been, or four times, or half. That's a long time, man. You go into 1,000 years, you really don't have we haven't been alive long enough to really compute that, but then you go into 1 million years, or 20 billion years. You're jumping over into sci-fi land now. You weren't there to see that, okay? You were not there. No one was there to see that. And all these conclusions that they come up with are so drastically different that you would place your soul's trust in this thing when there's no observable evidence of Darwinian evolution at all. There is no observable evidence of Darwinian evolution at all. Ask all these people and they say, I can give you thousands. Just give me one. They can't give you one because there is none. And there is no eyewitnesses there. Ken Ham says that one. I thought that was really good. But here's a good thing about the book of Genesis. I used to teach it this way because I never really understood it. Now I do. Everything in Genesis is eyewitness account. I used to think that if it was all written by Moses, then Moses must have had a 1800-year prophecy of writing all kinds of things that he had to have revealed to him. But it's not true. Every time it says, it starts giving you a genealogy and says, and these are the generations of so-and-so, like you see the 10 from, like, you know, Adam all the way to Noah. It's because the pen was handed on to the next guy. This guy's dying off and he's handing the next over here. So literally, the entire book of Genesis is all eyewitness accounts. So we can't say, oh, people say, oh, well, you weren't there, but someone was. Okay, there's a lot of history that we rely on, and people act like, oh, people wrote it. That was history. Of course it's true. Well, isn't it amazing that we don't want to look at the book of Genesis? This is the foundation of the theology of all that we believe in the whole entire Word of God. So you throw out the book of Genesis and you got a lot of problems. That's why there's a lot of people fighting against the book of Genesis and a lot of key places where the power of God come down. The flood of Noah and the creation and just so many other artifacts that we hear about in the book of Genesis. Just from 1 to 11 alone is a lot. You mess with any of that stuff right there and you've opened up a lot of room for messing people up severely. You get people's minds in the wrong direction and they will be able to reason away their God-given conscience and push God away and commit sin and never be set free by the Son of God himself. They'll never be set free because they'll always have another reason why I don't need to worry about that. But there's no observable evidence at all to prove one kind of an animal has ever changed into another kind of animal. There's not one. Not one. So, we have eyewitnesses here, and we don't have it over here. Nothing didn't create everything. God created everything. Amen. So, now we know there is actually 10 writers in the book of Genesis. I didn't know that. 10 writers in the book of Genesis to lay down eyewitness accounts. Okay, now that's one way to lay down the scripture. Now, that's not exactly a revealed knowledge, except for like stuff like, you know, the Lord would show up to Abraham or the two angels, or something would happen from the divine and come in union with a man, a mortal man, and go, whoa, this is serious. You know, a lot of times you'd see people falling on their face and they're afraid of even an angel. And they're getting some type of divine revelation and they write it down. The revelation is the beyond coming here and giving a message of some sort or something happening, a miracle of some sort, and then they're writing it down. That's the inspiration part, okay? To me, they both sound the same, but that's the way that this thing is accounting for it, saying that the inspiration part is the written material that was revealed. Now, it's trying to get into this thing, which I don't really understand. It says it's possible to have a revelation without inspiration. Now, that doesn't make any sense to me, because to me, that doesn't make any sense. But it says, like, when John is on the island of Patmos and he hears the voices of seven thunders in Revelation 10, 3 and 4, he says he heard the seven thunders and he starts getting ready to write down, but the voice from heaven says, don't write down anything. Write it not. So there is no documentation of whatever happened just then. So that would have the revealing that it actually did happen, but he says, I couldn't write it down. And believe it or not, the Lord does all kinds of things to me day and night throughout the week, and for the last over 10 years now, God has been putting stuff in me, and I get ready to record it, no. Get ready to write it down, no. Don't do this. There's a reason for it. It's like I'm putting it in you, and it's going to be for down the line, and you're just going to have to trust when it comes out, or whatever, I don't know. But that's happened, like, half the time the Lord moves, I've only received about half of them. I only captured about half of them, and even among the ones I've got captured, I didn't always get it just right. I couldn't capture it the way I see in it in the spirit. So that's kind of the kind of the same thing where the Lord would tell John, you saw the seven thunders, don't write it down. It's not that. So there's no written documentation of it, but it was still revealed. The next one, it's also possible to have inspiration without revelation. So it says, talking about the writers, both old and new, sometimes they wrote things down that they witnessed with their own eyes, or they've done their own research. It's pretty fair, you know. So the originality, because they actually saw it and they wrote it down, doesn't qualify for inspiration, but the scriptures are inspired altogether. All scripture is inspired and God-given. Amen. that's a tiny bit of the bibliology that I'm going to touch on right now. There's a lot to talk about, but I don't want to get into it too much. And there's a few other ones that are, this is kind of what I was starting to talk about in the beginning, is six different theories that would try to disarm or to discourage us from seeing the inspiration of the Word of God, to try to question it or something like that, which some people try to do. And like I heard one guy, he's famous for talking against the Word of God, which I still don't agree with, to say that the Bible is not the Word of God, or some of it is and some of it isn't. That's not the way you handle God's Word, amen? We have to take the whole thing and say that's God's Word, and every part matters whether I understand it or not, you know? So that one is, that's one of the attacks against it. They're liberal theologians. They will say that the Bible contains the Word of God along with words of and ideas of men. They're mixing the two, words of God and words of men, and you don't really know. Well, that makes you question it. Like, how am I supposed to know, is this one really of the Lord and this one really isn't, you know? And in 1 Corinthians 7, you've got Apostle Paul. He says, this is from the Lord, and this is, he says, now this is me, not of the Lord, but I have permission to speak this thing. This is not a command of God. This is me speaking, but I believe I have the Holy Spirit. So you can see all the different levels of people trying to use the scripture to say that this is not really inspired. They try to look at it under a slightly different light to make it look like it's not really specific or special, you know. And also some people will try to say that the Bible is dead unless it's being divinely taken in at that one given moment. If someone's not having a divine moment where the Lord is making it clear to you, then the Bible is dead. But that's not true. It just means that not a divine thing happened. The Bible is inspired totally. All scripture is given by inspiration and for reproof and for doctrine and all the others that we saw. So those are pretty much the things I wanted to share tonight. It was kind of a short one. It's going to be a good time for a short word so we can go into the street and share everything else that we know, because there's a lot we know that the world doesn't know. Amen.
Can I ask a question in that case?
Okay.
You know how it says that women are supposed to wear scarves and all that? And if, you know, if all scripture is inspired and blah, 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 mm-hmm. People never say that about that. They say it's a cultural thing and they talk it away. Mm-hmm. But how can we do that if all scripture is inspired and for reproof and correction and everything else? So what do you think of that?
Yeah, that's a good subject. That's, like I said, there, like every group I get around, they will magnify a certain, kind of a certain zone that they get in. And in that certain zone, certain things mean a lot and certain things are, oh, that doesn't matter, you know. Like among the groups that do really, really emphasize covering their heads. They have their things they emphasize, and they have their points, and nothing always wrong with everything that they say, but then there's also stuff that they totally ignore as well, you know? So, like I said, every group changes their mind. So what do I think about the whole thing? Why does it say that in the scriptures?
No, my question is not, why is it in there?
Okay.
My question is, why are we ignoring something if all scripture is inspired by God?
Well,
whatever
I think...
Whatever it is, I'll just use that one example.
Yeah, that's one example. There's a ton of them. And for that one specifically, I feel like people should finish the chapter. They should finish the verses a little before and a little after. And in there, I haven't looked at the original language, you know. I haven't looked at the original language to find out what does the covering say. What covering mean? Because it tells you at the end of that thought, it says that the woman's hair should be long for a covering for her. She should be covered. And a man shouldn't have long hair because he should have his hair uncovered, his head uncovered. You know, and so, but that does neglect a little bit, because in the Old Testament it talks about having locks covered, meaning your hair is not your covering.
Yeah.
But there was something to cover your locks.
Right.
And of course, the Middle East is pretty much where the whole emphasis of the word, this piece of history was written, you know, in Syria, in the Middle East, in Egypt, in Africa, but, you know, all that kind of area over there. And they did cover their heads a lot anyway, because the sun was atrocious over there. They covered their bodies a lot. Even men did. It wasn't like, that wasn't something that was like, I don't know why they said don't talk over here, you know. All I know is that God leads certain people, and he does, you know, I think he's like kind of like in and out with people, you know what I mean? Because like I said, groups like this, I see their strengths and I see their weaknesses. And I get around other groups, I see their strengths and I see their weaknesses over here too. But it's like, when I'm hearing real preaching, and I'm saying, now that is God, okay? And I look at these people receiving the word, and I hear them hearing the Lord, and I hear them being fed, and I'm saying, this is what I'm all about right here. Look across the thing, almost never do I see head covers. Never, almost never do I see that emphasized. And now I'm not saying that maybe we'll have a great revival and God will say, hey, start covering the heads, you know, because in the spirit, truthfully, like the Lord has just plowed me this week in prayer. I'm just like, God, you know, just show me something real. And he did show me something real. And it's huge. It's a lot of big changes in my world. And I'm like, man, you know, so anyway, go ahead.
I was taught that in Israel, if you were a harlot, you'd have your head covered, like in Judah with Tamar. She covered herself, which made her look like a harlot. Now, in other countries, they believe a woman who did not have any morals would not wear a head covering, and that's why that was brought up, because it means different things in different cultures.
Well, that's beside the point. I'm just trying to make a point.
Yeah.
Forget about the head covering. That was just an example.
Okay.
I'm just saying that it seems like you're saying, different groups. I mean, why is there no group that takes everything serious, regardless what it is?
Yeah.
Well, I guess in that case, letters become your God, and not the leading of the Spirit becomes your God. You know what I'm saying?
So the Holy Spirit guides you into a certain place, and at that phase in your life, you're supposed to concentrate on that.
Yeah, whatever he's letting you know, because like, he changes things in my life against my own will and lets me feel at peace in places I normally wouldn't think this is what I want, you know. There's things that where he wants, his will is the peace for those that really are washed. They really are washed for their regeneration. They really have a new, like God's DNA in them. And they have an eternal something in them that makes them, now, of course, you're in union, we're in this world, but we're not of it, we're in him and of him. You know, Father's in the Son, the Son's in, and we are in Jesus now. We're all together. So because of our new life, wherever he is speaking to us individually and corporately sometimes, movemently, however he's going to be moving us, we're going to find our rest where he wants us to be. You know,
okay.
And I don't know why certain groups will emphasize that or the other. Like I did a word, I'm not sure if you were here last year, and Brother Gary was sitting over here, and I just did the whole word about 1 Corinthians, because it was amazing. In 1 Corinthians is so many divisive doctrines, you know, some of the groups that will head cover. What about the tongues? It talks about that 10 times more.
Yeah.
And there's diverse tongues.
Right.
And the people who make fun of the tongues, they don't recognize that there's diverse tongues. You know, which tongue are you making fun of? Because they all have a context. And it doesn't say that every tongue you shouldn't speak in. It's certain kind of tongues. Not everybody speaks in certain types of tongues. But there are four different types of tongues. They're diverse tongues. So, like I said, overall, the Word of God should be used for the Lord to speak to you individually, because it's about relationship. The Lord desires relationship. I am your shield and your exceeding and great reward, he says to Abraham. I am your shield. I am yours. I am your portion. And I think that when letters become an addiction, it's because of pride. And we are starting to commit sin. If the letters become addiction, then it's become sin. It's a different form of sin. We're more worried about how do we look on the outside as opposed to our inward heart adoring him as he is personally currently leading us. You know what I mean? That's just a different way of sinning. It's like Pharisee. They're more worried about their outward thing. They may mean it as obedience to the Lord. And so the Lord, in their ignorance, he might not nail them so hard, because there are certain places where he says that you aren't, this isn't sin to you because you aren't clear on this yet. You know, there's certain times when he will let you know that because you talk like you know everything, he's going to judge you according to that, because according to your attitude. You think you're so big, I'm going to hold you accountable to that standard that you think you're at. But to those that are humble and they really haven't got a light on certain things, that's why I don't always feel peace about, you know, correcting certain Christians, because they are, you know, they're kind of like, you know, doing things I don't think they should be doing, but they really haven't seen further than that, and it's not their time to be hearing certain corrections, you know what I'm saying? And so that's why we got to be led by the Spirit. You know, just that there, every Christian needs to be just like that. That's nonsense. Every Christian needs to be just like this, to seek the face of God, to be led by the Holy Spirit. And that is a very, very drastic changes that he'll be bringing in our lives. I believe he will. You going to say something?
No.
Oh, no.
I just had to go on,
sorry. Oh, you're good. Yeah, so, yeah, I really felt like today was, like, nothing to talk about at all. I just, like, everything I went over this week, it was so edifying, and none of it felt like a word for preaching. And so I'm just sharing exactly what I got. That's all I got. Actually, that's not all I got. I mean, I got so much, but none of it felt like that thing where I had to say something. That's what I'm, you know what I mean?
Well, what you just told me is really a big thing, though.
Okay.
You know, where, I mean, certain people, they're right here, and other people are right there, and, you know, various groups are at certain levels or certain places in the Bible because they're following the Holy Spirit. That's really very good, because, you know, if you know that, then you learn to become so more non-judgmental.
Yeah.
So that's really very good.
Yeah. It's kind of like the race differences, like we talked about before. And so, like, I believe in adaptation. You know, every group around the different worlds, they're going to adapt to their cultures, which is very, very different. They're going to adapt to their cultures, and they're going to adapt to the weather, you know, the conditions of their weather and whatnot. And their bodies will take a different form eventually, you know, not over millions of years, but even very short amount of time. Their bodies will change and adapt to what's going on, you know. So generally, you don't find extremely dark people in Iceland, you know. Usually you'll find them where the sun is extremely hot.
Yeah.
And when you start having the double B blood types, your skin's going to be really dark and be able to handle that. It can handle more heat, you know. Some people don't like a lot of heat. Like, I'm not exactly the lightest person ever, but I personally don't like a lot of heat. I like to be
either.
A little bit more normal. I'm like the fall kind of guy, you know. But the same way, cultures, different churches, they'll get around certain areas, and they're like, it's somehow that's the thing. You move out to the country, and then, oh, those people in the city, they're all crazy. It's like...
Yeah, it's funny, because I got, like, a little book today from the Gospel from Asia, and had, like, pictures of the missionaries and stuff in there. And there was one that had the, like, they were all, the whole group of the church was standing outside, and it was sort of, like, a picture, and they were all, like, very, like, joyful and happy and stuff. And then the preacher was on the side, and he had one of those, like, all Catholic-y type of
collar
thing. Backwards. Yeah. And I was like, oh, that's weird. And I was like, wait a second. And I caught myself. I'm like, who cares, like, what he's wearing? These people are truly, you know, serving the Lord and in the right spirit and stuff or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just, like, caught myself real quick. And I'm like, you know, I know there are certain things, but it's like, I mean, people can call themselves Pentecostal or Baptist or Catholic or whatever, but if somebody is truly of the Lord, then what they call themselves or what they may be wearing really shouldn't matter. If you know that they're true, truly, you know, doing the will of God.
Right.
So, what was I going to say? Oh, and then another thing, I believe what you're saying is right, because I can see where the Bible will say that the letters kill, because if you take anything and not living by the Spirit, then that could be like really horrible, because today I was reading about the Sadducees that came to Jesus, and they were like questioning him, and they said, well, in the days of Moses, it said that if a man is married to a lady and they didn't have any children, and then if he dies, then she's supposed to marry the brother. And so he's just giving an example. Okay, so there's seven brothers, and mm-hmm. they all die, and she doesn't. So whose wife is she really? You know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And Jesus was like, well, you err in scriptures and the power of God. Hmm. So I was like, okay, so who today, I mean, somebody could take that and say, well, look, I'm married to this lady, and, you know, whatever, something happens to me, the Bible says that my brother is supposed to marry, or, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
They could take that, like, literally and think that they're actually supposed to do that and start, like, a yeah. whole new cult or whatever.
Yeah.
Because they're being so literal and not yeah. living by the Spirit, but just by words. Yes,
yeah. Right.
So,
see, and that you see throughout the entire New Testament that people never got it. They never did. And I'm not saying that I got it all the time, but in the Spirit, it all makes sense, which is, you know, really extreme what moves the Holy Spirit. It's not like that every day. It really isn't. It's really nice and strong and all that, but to be able to see, whoa, that's really God's heart. Wow. But what God really meant for marriage, what God really meant for tongues, what God really meant for head coverings, what God really meant for family, what God really meant for authority, what God really meant for all these different things is so easily lost when we aren't in the Spirit, mm-hmm. you know, and you can find something that was said over here under a certain emphasis and bring it to a place that has a totally different emphasis and destroy them because it's not in the Spirit.
So, if you say in the Spirit, you mean with the fruit of the Spirit, like said in love, or behaved with grace and peace, or you yeah. know, all the fruit of the Holy Spirit?
Yeah, well, you know, like, it's I want to say yes, but at the same time, it's more than that, because, like the Bible says, answer a fool, answer not a fool. You have to know when to hold them and when to fold them. You know, Jesus oh. didn't flip every table over, but he did some, you know. He didn't. Say all the kids come talk to me, you know, because that's God in the Old Testament. He said, let the bear come over here and take him down, you know. He didn't say, he said, suffer the children to let them be eaten by a bear or she bear, you know what I mean? So, I mean, in the Spirit is like, what is God saying right now? And it could look good and it could look bad to some, but when you're not, if you're not used to living a life in relationship to the Holy Spirit, then you're going to come up with all kinds of conclusions, and in our arrogancy, which is a very natural thing that people will never be delivered of totally, you know, it'll always be the first thing you want to jump back to is like, I don't want to look myself as not doing right, so I have to be right in my own eyes, even though the Lord weighs the Spirit, like we talked about, but where I'm at is okay, and I'm losing my point, but just, you have to know whatever is right for that moment, and that's what's right, you know.
Oh, and that's in the Spirit.
Yeah, in the Spirit could look like, I mean, it is love, joy, peace, and patience in relationship to God, but it might not look like love, joy to someone who's living a compromised life, you know, because like, the Bible says in Revelation, it says that the church, he says, you're miserable, naked, wretched, and blind in God's eyes. He's God's, I see you as this, and you don't see yourself as that.
Yeah.
In your own eyes, you're wealthy, happy, successful, everything's great. He says, no, in my eyes, in the Spirit, you're wrong. You're wretched and blind. You know what I'm saying?
Kind of like what she was saying, the Old Testament is shadows of things, you know, like what you were saying about marrying the brother. That was a shadow of what Christ would be to us. There were several times a lot of the Israels got killed, and of course they had to keep the name of the 12 tribes going, because if a woman married out of the tribe, then she would lose her husband's stuff. And so that it's more, that kind of a thing was more for Israel cultural stuff.
Hmm.
Am I wrong in that?
I don't know. You know, I don't know Israel's culture. And stuff like that is it starts to get in.
Number 36 talks about that. These girls lost their husbands.
Yeah,
and
he just read that.
They went to Moses, and that's what they came up with to keep the
family name.
But you see, in this culture, you know, I get to keep my parents' stuff no matter what
happens. Well, that's what I'm saying. It's like people can read something that was not...
Doesn't
even apply to them.
Yeah.
And that, say, hey, well, the Bible says this, so we've got to do this.
Yeah, that's
what
ridiculous.
I'm saying.
Yeah, but some of it was to keep Christ, you know, so he could come... The first time.
Yeah. And yeah, I'm not saying it's wrong for what was happening then. I'm
but
just saying
we have a new covenant. So we can't stick to the old one. You can't put new wine and old skins kind of a thing.
Yeah.
But a lot of people do with the Bible.
Yeah. Ultimately, we are saved by grace through faith. Is this thing going?
It's still got the green.
There we go. But we are saved. We are saved by grace through faith, okay?
Yeah.
And as we look at the list of salvation, here's the 12 pieces here. Okay? We get the 12 pieces of salvation, and that is salvation, okay? And how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? It's a lot more than just being born. If your born was really real, this will make sense to you without even having read it. You know, I had a desire to preach, and I had a desire to get victory over sin. I had a desire to... truly repent, because when you want to stop committing sin, you say, God says stop committing sin, okay, I'm going to stop for real. When you are for real about not sinning, God will say, oh, good, let's get to work now, you know, now that you're not lost, then let's get you saved. And so, we are saved by God's grace, that can be real, through faith, okay, and in faith chapter, it shows you people in union with the voice of the Holy Spirit every time. So what is faith? We are saved by God's grace because his voice is speaking and we're listening to him. And without that, it's impossible to please him. And that's what we were made for. Everything was made for his good pleasure. So if we are not going to apply ourselves to what he is telling us, he's getting no pleasure from us. And this is becoming something that it wasn't meant to be. It's not a living thing. It's kind of a letter thing that we... In our religious pride, we go from righteousness with God to religious pride. And every group wants to find their religious pride, and they can start, well, I got a testimony. And we come from a history of these kinds of people that had all these great persecutions and all these great things that they did, and this is who we believe in today. Religious pride. That's what they said when you stand before the Lord. He says, I never knew you, but said, but Lord, we were part of a group that went all the way back to the New Testament. You know, they always said something other than, I know you. I obeyed you. You know, he said, you live like I never gave you a law. You live, you're lawless. You know what I'm saying?
They were trying to do it through good works, not through Jesus.
Yeah, because
they were saying, I did this. They didn't say, Jesus, you helped us do this. They took it all over. They just, well, I raised aspirin from the dead, you know. I didn't do it, God did it. But they're stealing his glory by saying they did it.
Well, he said that they were living wrong. He said, you live like, he said, you depart from me, ye cursed, you know, you lawless. He was calling them lawless. People who live like there are no godly parameters. And there are. Okay, you want to live outside of the godly parameters? You are in union with the devil, it says in John 8. And he says he sets you free. Don't tell me about no sin. Don't tell me about stop sinning, Brother Robbie. You know, that's what they'll do. We are free. I'm like, you are set free from committing sin. You're not set free to commit sin. So you took that scripture and you made it so backwards, it's not even funny. And they say, can you tell me the context of the scripture? They can't tell you the context of scripture because they learn from false prophets who just take one verse and they make a sermon out of it and they don't even know what they're talking about. Hey, God set you free. You know, they make the emphasis all about freedom to do whatever you want. And then they say that scripture, it's in the Bible. Yeah, it's in the Bible, but you took it out of context to make these devils continue to be unconcerned and unconverted. That's horrible.
Yeah.
So before the throne of God, you see what he says. He says two couple things that you see before the throne of God. One is him saying, I never knew you, and you lived like a devil. You lived like there was no parameters. The other one was, you never did anything. So people sit there going, quit preaching works. I'm like, I'm just following the Lord's example. He said, you didn't do anything. There was people hungry. You didn't do anything for them. I was in prison. You did nothing for them. You know? He says, don't tell me you have faith if you don't even love. How abideth the life in love in you? How abideth the love of God in you if you see someone hurting and you don't even do anything? He says, that's just no-brainer. That's kindergarten stuff. But you've gotten so religiously right that you have forgotten the obvious. And I'm right over here. You're over here. Being religiously right, so every man will look at you and know that you're the best Christian in the world. Go ahead, you be God's best. You want to be right, like the hamster wheel. Remember, I know I'm right, I know I'm right, I know I'm right. And they get into this little cycle of religion, I know I'm right religion, and you have all the reasons in the Bible why you know you're right, but you don't know the obvious. You're not even warm, you're not kind. The holiness of God is not like that. That's not the narrow way. You know what I'm saying? Amen. Are you lost?
I started.
Oh, you were thinking about something else?
I started thinking about my daughter.
You? I didn't know you thought about her.
So I drifted.
That's okay. My point is that the Bible shows you the scripture. It shows you the throne. It gives us a preview of what's going to happen at the throne and what people are going to be saying when they're not going. You know, with people who are going, they did something with their faith. People who did it, they didn't do anything with their faith. And someone was hurting and they did nothing. They just walked right by like they didn't realize something was going on. I think some of those extremist Christians should make it their business to try to help the hurting and see what it feels like. See if the Lord says, I've been waiting for you to do that all my life. You know, I've been waiting for you all your life. I've been waiting for you to show some compassion. So that's me. That's Jesus. Then I'll be your shield and your exceeding reward when you start acting like me. You know, we saw what he did. He was compassionate to the sinners. He was not compassionate to the religiously right. Amen. He didn't care what they had to say. He said, you guys are all messed up. You're my best. And you are my best. You're my best wrath. You're my best under the wrath people.
Amen. Yeah, we should have given so many to those people that we said sorry to. Remember we walked past those guys that were begging for money and we said sorry and we walked right by them.
Well, that's okay. Yeah. That don't even, when it comes to that kind of thing,
you don't know.
You don't know. Like I said, you answer a fool, answer not a fool. And not to be mean, but I've dealt with a lot of homeless people. And they are really good at making you feel horrible for not helping them out. But the truth is, they're homeless in a land of opportunities. There's so many opportunities here. Anybody can get their own car, their own apartment, their own whatever. It's not that hard. A little hard work won't kill you, but it will them. Because they're living in their own little world of, I don't have to do that. The rules don't apply to me. That's all it is. Almost every time.
Yeah, if you want to give your money, I would give it to
starving people.
Or people in different countries.
Yeah.
Gospel for Asia.
Yeah, give it to an organization instead of the individuals, because a lot of the times you might be support enabling them to drink or something.
Yeah.
You might.
Yeah, don't forget. But just so you know, like that, like anything, there's no every time do this, every time do that. Here's the every time. Every time, Lord, is this all right with you?
Right.
Someone comes up to you and says, hey, can you pray about this for me? I don't know. Let me go pray about whether I can pray about that or not. That's the prayer of wisdom, to go and pray the prayer of faith. A lot of different styles of prayer. And like I said, the same as like that, you know, this cheap Christianity they want. The prayer of faith is the granddaddy of all prayers. You know, you're not just praising him, prayer of praise, and the prayer of all these things. You're leading up to this mega, like Shekinah, let me pray for this thing in faith where the Lord's speaking and doing great things. That's still God leading, you know. But this modern thing is just like people are like, I have the power to pray for anything. Well, you don't have any prayer for praise. You don't have any prayer for Thanksgiving. You're not, you know, all these things, prayers of confession, of sin. They continue in their sin and they're praying the prayer of faith. God, do this. It's like Jesus didn't even do that. Except for, you know, when he went to raise Lazarus, he said, Lord, I thank you that you hear me. Father, I thank you that you hear my prayers. And he was asking him to do this thing. He asked for the 5,000, you know, fed and stuff like that. But a lot of the times he says, I only do what my Father's doing. And then sometimes he would ask, but he was in such union with the Father that those things did work, you know. And so, same as their cheap salvation. They got cheap prayer, big prayer. I'll pray for anything. You know what I mean? And Paris Radiohead says that's not true. He says you have. He says if someone asks him, he says, now I know. If someone says, can I pray? He says, I'll pray about that and find out, can I agree with you to pray for that? Which is really, really important.
That's actually really interesting because that just happened to me the other day.
Oh.
Where somebody said, oh, can you pray about this specific thing or whatever?
Yeah.
And usually I'm like, yeah, of course, whatever,
right.
You know. But then I was feeling kind of like, is that right? And so my reply was, I don't know what I replied, but basically saying, I will pray about the situation.
Yeah.
Like, you know, whether
it's
I got this in the mail. It's a video, short little video from Gospel for Asia about somebody's life, a little boy that talking about prayer. It's called The Prayer of the Meek, about the children that were praying.
Power of the Meek. The DVD, okay.
Yeah, so I don't know if you maybe want to pop it on sometime when we're eating.
Oh, okay.
Should be short.
Yeah. So, yeah, anyways, I was going to apologize that I didn't have something to share, but I feel like it's fine to have this kind of a thing, because it's not about going through the motions, you know? And if the Lord's not speaking, then why try talking? I've tried it before, and it doesn't work. You know, I'm not a book reporter, you know? I'm a preacher, and almost every week the Lord will show up to give an obvious word. And some of the words that I've looked back at when I felt this word worse than this, and I worked back at it, and there was a moment for it to minister back to me. And so almost everything that's been recorded in this thing has ministered to me another time. And that was my original point for making them. And if anybody else can find any benefit from it, so be it. 1,100 plus now. Under a month went another 100. It's been going up like up to 7 people a day. It used to be like 1, 1.5 a day. And like Friday it was like 6 or 7. It's just every day is like a few more coming on, so it's something. But I still feel like there's things that are going to have to get repositioned in order for the floodgates to really fly, because it's not. I mean, I think God takes things up really, really slow before things really kick into overdrive, because if the overdrive happens, the war against your soul is sometimes you're not ready, you're not used to fighting the devil at that level, and we have to be smart enough to know how to fight the devil and not have open doors that you're ready to fly open and mess up your life and throw the ministry down. Because God's name's writing on the ministry. He's writing on the life of believers. And the devil wants to destroy your testimony. It's his goal. The whole army of the devil come to destroy this testimony of those that are trying, that are really on the right track. They really come, they've been washed. And the devil wants to destroy your testimony and make you look like an idiot. How are you going to salty it up again? It says, how can you re-salt that thing again? It says, it's worth nothing. Throw it in the thing. Just let it be trampled. It can't be salty. It can't. I was like, I don't want to lose salty. Amen. I don't want to lose salty. We need to be serious. And so I'm watching some of the old ones, and I was scaring myself. I'm like, man. I was like, thank God that the Lord would lay down some of these words. If you ever can go back and watch that one, it's called Are We Being Taught to Blaspheme? Remember that word?
Yeah, I got it.
Whew. Man, that was a scary word. And it's so funny how intense I used to get. I'd be like, oh. And it was like right on the money, too. It's like right on the money. I was like, no, Pope. You know what I mean? It was good. So. New Man and Showman.
Yeah, that was a good one. That was a scary one.
There's some really good words. That's what I tell people on my page. I'm like, yes, it's not like that. It's long and sloppy. But in the midst of the quantity, there has been some very quality moments that have happened in here that has been just really, really spectacular. No one has to grab any of our songbooks, because I have a few songs on the page here. So we're going to go ahead and change pages. And I can look on the screen to see the songs. There it is. Here's the new one. Another thing I was thinking about, it was really cool how I'm really grateful to be raised as a preacher in the house church. You know why?
Why?
Because when I first started doing this, I could feel the grieving of the spirit wanting to do the things I normally do by being loud and really going crazy and stuff like that. And just, you know, years ago when I started ministry, I wanted to do worship leading in a church. And I literally, if it wasn't a Baptist church who was against all that I believed, because I was very charismatic, I wanted to, like, cast out demons and do all kinds of spiritual things during the church service. And I'm just like, the Lord is really good to keep you in a position where you can't do it. I mean, He kept me here where I don't get to go ballistic and raise my voice and stuff like that. It's really neat. And so now that I'm in a church building, which we can do, now that I'm in a church building, I can raise my voice, and I don't want to. I actually talk quieter still. And so there'll be chosen moments when the Lord wants to show up, and the fire can come on, and we'll know it's of the Lord, you know, no problem.
We need a big voice, because the still small voice is louder than any human voice. And it caused Elijah to tremble when he was still small.
Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks.
on everywhere, Lord. All the preachers are at, Lord, to touch the lost and dying world, that all can come to sight, that all can come to the saving knowledge of the Son of God. Someday the seal of the call will ring, and I know more than thou shalt see, but all the joy when I shall wait within the palace of the King, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my dream. And I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace. Someday my earthly house will fall. I cannot tell when that shall be. Unless I know my all and all has now a place in him for me. And I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my grace. And I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my grace. Someday when fades the golden sun beneath the rosy tinted rain, my blessed Lord will say well done, and I shall learn to meet to rest, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my grace. And I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my grace. Someday till then I'll watch and wait. I lay all dreamed and moving bright, and as I lay beyond the gate, my soul to him may take its flight. And I shall see him face to face and tell the story, see my grace. And I shall see shall see face to face and tell the story, see my grace. And I shall see face to face and tell the story, see my grace. Last week when I was dropping you off, did you get that message? I saw some people downtown with a big banner.
Oh, yeah.
I said, I've never seen anybody with a big banner other than myself in all the years I've been doing this, except for that one guy. Actually, he did have a banner, but I did. And we did run into him just randomly. I've never just been kind of like, I don't know. Because I went down to that place to street preach, and then he had a big banner. And I went downtown to street preach, and someone had a big banner. That's the second time I've ever seen someone with a big sign over their head in person, you know. I was just talking about last week, I said, hey, we don't have any big banners anywhere. And then I went down there and someone had like the 4x4 banner, which is pretty good size.
Did you stop and say hi?
I was going to, but they were all, I honked my horn and I thought they'd see my truck and think, oh, praise the Lord. But they didn't care. They just kept talking. They were like in a group circle around the big, the, you know, the sign, and whoever was, some other guy was talking. I was like, okay. Usually I was thinking it'd be fun to go out there. It's like, this time I want to go down there with my megaphone, because I was looking at that going, his sign says something about Jesus will forgive all sins. And I was like, okay. And his shirt said Jesus hates sin. I was like, that's good. And I still felt like, I'm like, that's why I wanted to, that's why I like that Korean sign, because it's like letting you know something. It's like more than just passing by. I can look at it. I don't know. Sometimes I feel like it's not like saying, stop, listen. You know what I mean? I don't know how to describe it. So I liked it, but I couldn't couldn't find the chords to list that sounded right. I haven't got this one down all the way yet, but you can do this thing. Here it is. Man of sorrows, what a name.